I'm Ila Saxena, and I'm editor at Apparel Resources, the publishers of the industry flagship magazines Apparel Online, which has editions in India, Bangladesh, and Vietnam, and of course the fashion tech magazine Stitch World. We are also the organizers of Apparel Sourcing Week, India's premier global sourcing show, which has manufacturers from Asia and buyers from around the world. We all know, and we've all been facing this for the last practically 2 months, so how COVID has impacted our lives, our businesses, every aspect of the world today. But it has also created a huge opportunity for the garment industry because of the body coveralls that are so critical for the medical professionals. And many of the factories are now looking at getting into this category. But of course, that doesn't mean it's easy. And there are, being a relatively new product, it involves a lot of uncommon raw materials, processes, and it's very imperative that we do it right the first time and always. This webinar is specially targeted at the knowledge and capacity building of the garment manufacturers and to address the three critical areas of PPE, that is raw material, technology, and of course the actual manufacturing of PPE. To throw light on the subject, we have with us three experts who will talk about these three critical areas. And guiding us through the webinar is Dr. Professor Parveen Jana, NIFT Delhi. I'm sure a lot of you must be knowing Dr. Jana. He's a visionary thinker, a renowned writer, and a seasoned speaker. He also has the distinction of being the Shahi Chair Professor, Industry 4.0 at NIFT. He will be joined by Dr. Rashmi Thakur, Assistant Professor, NIFT Mumbai. She's an expert in non-woven application and filtration, and is also the CEO of Design Innovation Incubator on Smart Wearable Systems at NIFT Mumbai. The third person who is gracing this panel is Anjuman Dash, founder of Unique Technologies. He's very critical to this particular webinar because he is considered one of the key players in seam sealing technology, which is also very important for the overall manufacturing industry. Mr. Dash is also the director of H&H Asia, a leading manufacturer of seam sealing bonding and ultrasound welding technology for the sewn product industry. The session will be followed by a question and answer round wherein Dr. Jana will pick up the most upvoted questions for the panelists. So attendees, please don't forget to vote for the questions that you think are very relevant for the webinar. But before I hand over the baton to Dr. Jana, I would like to share with you that Apparel Resources is introducing a PPE resource guide, which will connect people working in the PPE industry. And as you can see in this slide, it is a new and updated resource guide wherein you will get contact details and names of suppliers, users of PPE coveralls, and also authentic reference points for the technology, the raw materials, the testing agencies, and also the standard guidelines and best practices to be followed for the PPE industry. I'm sure you'll all be very excited to know more about this. So interested parties can raise a request at contact@apparelresources.com, and my team will be very happy to guide you through this. Now, without wasting more time, I hand over the baton to Dr. Jana for an engaging session. Dr. Jana, please.
Thank you, Ila. Good afternoon and namaste. First of all, I'd like to thank Apparel Resources for organizing the webinar on this exciting topic of PPE, which is absolutely topical and need of the hour. The panel members joining with me are Dr. Rashmi Thakur from Mumbai and Anshuman Dash from Bangalore. I'd like to start by saying that PPE is a category of product, not a product. We need to first remember that, because a lot of cases I've seen that, you know, we are saying that we are manufacturing PPE. So it's not that we are manufacturing a PPE, because that consists of many products. So one of the products which we are going to discuss in today's webinar is the body coverall. I'd like to just share my screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So before we get into the topic of the challenge of making PPE, the body coverall, if we look at in the recent times, because probably every day in the newspaper, we see some news or about PPE, what is going on about masks. So this is about DRDO developed that liquid glue technology for making PPE. Then the BIS has released the standard and then withdrawn within 3 days of releasing. Then this is yesterday's news, the Navy has made a PPE and which is they have also patented. And today's morning news, it says in the last 3 months, only 30% PPE has passed the quality test. Probably from the context of this, which is incidental, probably the today's morning newspaper news and our webinar date. Because I hope this 70% of those which have not been passed, I think some of them probably attending this webinar and probably some of their queries will get addressed by this. And that is our purpose of capacity building the appeal to the people who are planning to make the PPE, which is as in specific the body coverall. If you get into the definition of that, what is body coverall, which is actually one piece jumpsuit type loose fitting garment with full sleeve, full leg and fitted with hood. Then there are elastic attached in the opening of the hood, wrists and ankle. And there is also a loop attached to the wrist to anchor the sleeves in place. The coveralls should resist the penetration of liquids and liquid-borne microorganisms. That is one of the key parameter for a body coverall, which is actually the raw material related parameter. Now, if you see that what this resistance standard should follow, it says that various standards should be compliant to ISO 16603, equivalent ASTM 1670, which is resistance to synthetic blood and body fluid penetration. And this is a test which is almost everybody is experiencing going through all these 8 different labs throughout India. The coverall also should pass ISO 16604, which is equivalent ASTM 1671. This is necessary to categorize a coverall in the standard of AAMI level 4, which is internationally recognized as the necessary to fight this COVID-19. Now, when you get into the coverall designs and pattern making, we'll just go through a small video to just understand that what exactly it is. Now, what we are seeing here, there are different types. Now, what you see in the video right now is this is a medical gown, which has a slit. There are 2 types of gowns. There's a very little difference on that. So there are different places in the world and for different circumstances, the people wear this. This does not have a bifurcated legs, which has some advantages for some wearer. What we see here is the medical drape, which is not covering the whole body. Like in the backside, if you see, there is an empty. These are called drapes. Now, what you see here is that coverall, which we are going to discuss today, except the face and the palm, the whole body is covered. Now, this coverall actually consists of 8 different pattern components. We'll see how the pattern components actually join together to make the coverall and how it behaves when the doctor is actually wearing the coverall and actually moving and doing his job. This video is put together by Tukatek using a 3D simulation technology. So which actually before making the sample physically, we should be able to virtually make the sample and see that how exactly it is going to fit the human body. So we need to remember though that this is not a fitted garment. So we are not actually going to check the, because it's not a body hugging garment, but this is actually going to show you that how exactly it is going to behave with the human body when somebody is going to wear it. This particular style is having it at 1.4 width of fabric has a consumption of 2.6 meter. And in 1.6 meter width of fabric, it has a consumption of 2.1 meter with an efficiency of around 76 to 83%. Now we can see here, like when how the coverall is, you know, let's say interacting with the body, all this red color shows that these are the stress points. This is, you know, important to remember, because while actually creating this, that how exactly the engineering should be done. And this is another style which is having only 6 component. Why I'm showing another style is this is one of the probably most popular style being currently being manufactured in India. Now we need to understand that number of pattern reduces, that technically probably the join area also, the joining length, that means the seam length also reduces, which gives an opportunity to having safe time for construction. Also the less propensity of, you know, having this barrier probability or this, you know, penetration probability also reduced. So looking at two different styles and how exactly it behaves in the human body, if you see, these are more or less similar. Now this is having also the almost a similar conjunction pattern. So when you see here, here also the stress points are almost similar. So this gives us that these are the two different styles, which are, there can be, you know, little variation of this style also. If we get into the vital parameters of the coverall pre-sewing, now fabric conjunction, because these are generally done using the non-woven fabrics, with an GSM of 60, the fabric conjunction is around 200 to 219 grams, depending on that what fabric width you are using and what kind of styles you are doing. This is the fabric consumption, not the actual PP weight, which will be around 80% of this amount. Now for this total cutting time using a CNC cutting machine for a 2A marker of this is approximately, both the styles is approximately 7 minutes. Seam sealing tape consumption is approximately 9 meters. Now we need to remember, very important is that we need to avoid face-to-face spreading of the bilaminate fabric. This is to ensure that the fusing possibilities are reduced, because we need to remember that we are using a thermoplastic fiber. So the fusing possibility is very high. And if the cutting machine has a knife pulling feature, then obviously we need to use that. Last but not the least, we need to remember at no conditions fabric should be handled in such a way that any pin should not be pricking the fabric. Then the whole effort of having this fabric, special fabric, and protecting the doctors from this infection actually has been destroyed. When you're going into the technology options, so we have the first option is actually sewing plus taping, which is one of the most popular option currently, not only in India, throughout the world. So in that case, what we do is that we do the sewing first, and after that, the sewn seam is gone through the two rollers, where this blue color is the tape, and you can see the hot air is coming out, which is adequately melted. Now, what we are seeing here is the seam area is sealed by a seam tape. This is very important that we need to remember that this side, you need to do the seam taping. If you go to the next technology, which is ultrasound welding, and in this process, there's only one step process to join the fabric. So there is. So in this technique, actually, what we do is that it one step, the joining of the fabric happens, and then it is, there is no porosity in the joint. This is not very commonly used technology, though, although this has the advantage of doing joining in the one stage, but the technology options are not available currently, and throughout the world also not very well explored. But probably this is a very important technology. Why? Because it actually can reduce the making time probably nearly 60% of the current time of sewing plus joining. And there is a recent news shows that during this pandemic in Sweden, there is a company which has started making the coverall who are using 100% ultrasonic bonding technology. So which means that it is definitely doable. So in going ahead, probably some of the manufacturers can think about this option also. Now the third probably option, which is a kind of futuristic. So if you see, like a lot of discussion is happening that probably is this PPE making is a stopgap, or is it going to be taken up by some organization as a additional product category? So we need to definitely think in future. So what we are now struggling is that how to, during the joining process, how to seal that join. So if we do not have a seam, then we don't have need to bother about sealing the seam. So if we can make a probably seamless coverall, which is we can think about doing in the future, because otherwise there are a lot of garments which are actually seamless made. So that can be a, you know, way forward going ahead. So which does not need any taping or joining possibilities. Now, if we look at the coverall manufacturing journey in India, which is the background of this, which is very important if we try to see. As on 27th of March, there is only one approved fabric supplier. And as on today, the list says there are 257 which are approved. As on March 28th, there are only 8 coverall manufacturers in India. And as on May 7th, there are 172. As on March 28th, India's capacity to produce coverall was 10,200 coveralls per day, which is by this 8 coverall manufacturer. As on May 1st, the India's capacity has gone up to 187,000. And the last, on 27th of March, according to some conservative estimate, India has 600 hot air seam sealing machine installed. And those machines were actually with the garment manufacturer who are probably already engaged in outerwear manufacturing or rainwear manufacturing. So that's where also hot air seam sealing machine was used. So that was existing probably capacity, which the discussion was how we can convert those capacity into making coveralls. As on today, additional 900 machines are already installed in India within a space of around 40 odd days. And the numbers are counting, and some estimates say there are more than another 600 expected to arrive. So if you look at this context, so which is very important, so you see that the fabric manufacturer at one side is increasing. So there are more and more people are wanting to make fabrics. So that is an area where probably we need to take a look at that. What is the technology behind fabric and what actually goes on? So my fellow speaker is going to discuss on that. Second is actually this, how this technology of the seam sealing machine is taking, you know, what all critical parameters need to be taken care. So we are going to discuss on that. So on this note, actually, I'd like to hand over to Rashmi, who will take you through the fabric. Thank you very much for your kind patience and going through this presentation. Rashmi will take over now.
Rashmi, it is mute. You need to open.
Thank you, Professor, and a very good afternoon. Namaste to all. First of all, I would like to thank Apparel Resources for giving me this opportunity. And before I start with just going to the raw material selections for the coverall fabrics, I would just like to highlight you the critical thing which we are trying to address here. So if you just look at this graph, so you would understand that the mean particle size of this virus, which we are trying to protect our healthcare workers and others as well, is of range 0.1 micrometers. Now, having said that, so these are the few things which we want to obstruct the fabric for, that is the water droplets or any of the bodily fluids, the droplet-borne virus, the aerosols, which has these virus. But at the same time, what we require is to provide them with water vapor permeability. That is, the fabric should allow the water vapor to pass through, which is in the form of perspiration across our body. So we need to come up with a coverall fabric which would be giving barrier properties along with being breathable. So these two B's, which is the utmost important for designing a coverall fabric, has to be taken care of. Having said that, I move further to explain you this, that this is how a breathable ensemble consists of. So this is a typical three-layer breathable ensemble where the breathable membrane is sandwiched between the two non-woven fabrics. And you can see it is obstructing the liquid as well as the blood or any other bodily fluids to penetrate through. Whereas the vapor is able to pass through. That's why we call it as breathable ensemble. There are certain commercial fabrics or the breathable membranes existing. This particular video is just to make you aware that we have certain membranes existing. Here it shows that the water droplets is not being allowed to penetrate through the fabric, whereas it is allowing the water vapor. And it claims that it has a pore size which is 20,000 times smaller than that of water droplet, which obstructs it there over the fabric surface. Whereas the pore is 700 times larger than that of water vapor molecule, thus allowing the water vapor molecule to pass through. So this is what makes it breathable. You can understand it, the pores are very small here, still larger than that of the molecule of water vapor. Now this is something about the breathable ensemble. But of course, in the present scenario, what we are looking at is providing something additional. Not only this, that it obstructs the water droplets or the blood or the bodily fluid, but also gives a barrier to these viruses. And at the same time, should not obstruct air regulation as well as the perspiration, which is there over the skin. So we should understand the importance of it. If we do not have something which is breathable, then it is going to cause a sauna effect, which is nothing but a hot and humid environment next to our skin, which releases to increase in heart rate and widens the vessels. So for a longer duration, this is not advisable. So that will put our healthcare workers, they are going to be put into trouble. If we do not consider breathables, then we can well ahead go with the raincoats, which we used way back to our schools during rainy seasons. And you all can recall how uncomfortable it used to be. So we should go forward with something which is a breathable viral barrier. So giving barrier to the viral penetration as well as allowing the water vapor to pass through. So with that light, I would start with the discussion on materials and methods. So majorly the sector is dominated with the woven and the non-woven fabric as the base layer. And for the barrier layer, we have coating and lamination as two methods, which can be of two types, that is microporous as well as monolithic. Now, so in the existing market, we all understand textiles in terms of fabrics. We categorize them as wovens, non-wovens and knits. Wovens and knits, if you see, have quite regular structure, geometrical form, whereas non-wovens are in randomly arranged manner, and it is a fabric which is directly converted from fiber. Now, talking about knits, I must say that weft knit is something which is not very much recommended, being the fact that it is something which is elastic in nature. And there are certain flexing points and stress region when the healthcare workers are wearing it, which may lead to opening of the pores, also puncturing those membranes, thus affecting the barrier properties of these fabrics. Warp knits are, however, much stable than that of wefts and almost similar properties than that of what a woven fabric offers you. So that can still be considered as a base layer. So next we move on to the materials and properties of these base layers. Theoretically, we can pick up anything which is hydrophobic in nature for the raw material of making this base layer. However, the non-woven sector, especially the spun bond fabrics, are dominated by the polypropylene fibers because of its advantage of being light, being cheaper, being easy to engineer in the form of spun bond. Whereas for the wovens and knits, we majorly are seeing that the filament yarns of polyesters and nylons are being used to make these fabrics. Coming to their properties, again, I emphasize on these pore size and its distribution. If you have a look at this graph, you can make out that non-wovens are the fabrics which offer you smaller pore size, as well as it gives you wider pore size distribution. thus enabling the capturing of whatever particle you intend to, furthermore, easy and efficient. Not only that, it also has a randomly arranged fibers in its structure. This makes the path to be very tortuous, thus again adding the ability to capture the particles properly. Also, I mentioned, since it is being converted from fiber to fabric, so the production is fast, it is economical, and if you are looking for a disposable option, yes, of course, it's a good one, good option to choose from. Yeah, there lies some ecological impacts. I will be coming back to that if you are opting for the disposable coveralls. Further about these non-wovens, as I said, it's fiber to fabric. So whatever we engineer in fiber is simultaneously depicted in the fabric properties. Like if we have a finer fibers, then we have smaller pores. We are able to engineer it that directly. Also, if we reduce the fiber diameter, then the surface area, the total surface area offered by this fiber in the fabric increases. So these two are again an added advantage which is offered for capturing any particle, virus in our case, intended. Moving forward with the processes, I just mentioned we have coating and we have lamination. Now through this schematic diagram, what I want to communicate is that when we are going for coating, we end up most of the time blocking these pores, which is not the case for lamination. In the case of lamination, we are dealing with membranes, which we make the fabrics to adhere to, laminate to later. So there are two different components which we make them adhered or laminated. So there we have less chances of pores being blocked. So for any given point, if you talk about, then coating offers lesser breathability as compared to that of lamination. Now the polymers used are PVC, PP, PE, PU and TPU. Of course, PVC has been barred because of its ill effects. PU and TPU are good options, but costlier options. So the sector is majorly dominated by the two, that is PP and PE. Of course, we need to look into the seam sealing compatibility and all, which would be taken up by my fellow succeeding panelists here. So while I spoke about the coating, why it blocks the pores, there is a small video to just make you understand that if you look into the stage-wise progression of these coating, then in the very first stage, it first goes and blocks or goes on to the interstices of these yarns. Next, what it does, it goes on to the yarns itself. And if you keep on adding, because we feel if we keep on adding coating, we are improving the barrier properties. And we finally end up blocking the pores between the yarns as well, thus making it very less breathable. These are the factors which affects the stage-wise progression. And just for me to reiterate, porosity and solidity, two contradicting things to optimize the two other properties, that is breathability and barrier performance. We all understand if we increase breathability, we are going to compromise with the barrier performance. And if we increase barrier performance, we are going to compromise with breathability. So we should intend to optimize these both. So what are the methods of coating? There are several. I have just picked up the most common ones. In melt extrusion, you have this polymer melt, which is extruded through the die over the fabric, which is most suitable for the less porous substrate. The porous substrate may end up having a strike through. So therefore, foam coating is suggested for that, those less more porous substrate. For the case of lamination, again, we have several methods. Few of the most popular, the heat lamination and the adhesive bonding has been shown here. For the case of adhesive bonding, we opt for dot bonding, and there can be several methods. Here it's the gravure method, so that we do not apply the adhesive throughout the fabric, which otherwise would make the fabric again ruin its breathability as well as its drapeability and other properties. So these are the techniques for coating and lamination. Having discussed that, as now we are aware of the base layer and the barrier layer, we can very well come up with the permutation and combination of all these with the spun bond, melt blown, non-woven and woven and warp knits as the base layer and monolithic membrane, microporous membrane, monolithic coating and microporous coating. So if you have a look at it, the first five, they are the non-coated or the non-laminated category of these fabrics, these ensembles. Next six on the left are the coated ones, whether two layer or three layer. Next four are the bilaminated ones. Those are using membranes and two layers. And the last one is the one using membrane with three layers. So the membrane is sandwiched. So when you have a bilaminated layer, it's the barrier layer is placed on the outside. It's facing the environment. Next to your skin is the base layer. Whether it is a case of coating or lamination, in both the scenarios, it should be clear. Now coming up with the suggestions of these available. These are few of the combinations I just told. So of course, the single layer no way is going to meet with our requirement of providing the barrier properties. Even the SS, that is the two spun bond, also the SMS won't give you sufficient barrier protection. The others with the blue stock mark coming up here are good options, of course. They have sufficient barrier properties and breathability as well, I must say. But then, provided that you have these resources available, in India, we do not have a domestically manufacturing membrane company. We are importing them if at all we are using. So we are left with the coating options, which I discussed earlier. And so on the left-hand side, the six combinations for two layer and the three layers are the ones which are at this moment of crisis advised. But it is inevitable, and I must say that, of course, the tri-laminates with the membranes are one of the best options to take it up, whether on a non-woven base or on a woven base or on a knitted base. Now, moving further, I would like to come up with a few of the concepts here. So it's the time for demystification and for you people to interact with me through a poll, which you would be able to see right now on your screen. So it's something regarding to the GSM versus barrier properties. So it asks you, GSM of fabric does not decide the barrier properties of coveralls. I give you 10 seconds to answer this. Yes, so the time is up and I may have the poll results. What are attendees and the viewers have the opinion on this? Okay, so it's quite a balanced response. Half of you almost feel it has an effect, it decides the barrier property, and half of you feel it doesn't. So I'll just answer you this in one statement, that you know, GSM actually does not affect your barrier properties. That is what I have been speaking all this while. It's the pore geometry, it's the pore size, it's the pore size distribution of the barrier layer as well as the base layer, which decides the barrier properties. If you keep on increasing the GSM without altering the pore size for the intended capture of the particles, it is not going to improve. I suppose the reason for you, which you people consider maybe the affidavit, which few of the fabric manufacturers, you all have been asked to declare with the criteria like GSM and thickness and all these things. So let me tell you that it is not that if you keep on increasing GSM, you get an approval for being meeting up the standard of coveralls, or you would be able to get better barrier properties. It's not so. So GSM as low as 40 or 30 can also offer you a better barrier properties if you select correct raw material, correct barrier layer. Next in line is another poll for you, where I just want to know your opinion on air permeability and breathability. You would see it on your screen, a new poll asking you, again 10 seconds, so whether air permeability and breathability both indicate the same property of coverall fabric or not. I hope all of you have answered to this poll. So may I have the results of this polling on the screen, please? Okay. So around 40% of you feel that the air permeability and breathability both indicate the same property of coverall. So it's important for me to convey you that, clarify it further. And around 60%, 58% feel that it doesn't. So again, coming to this, air permeability and breathability are two different things, two different properties of a fabric. So air permeability is the ability of a fabric to allow air to pass through it. whereas breathability is the ability of the fabric to allow water vapor to pass through it. That is what we have been talking about. So water vapor in the form of perspiration in our case for the coveralls. Air permeability is expressed as centimeter cube per centimeter square per second. That's the common unit used for it. Whereas breathability is quantified by something known as MVTR or WVTR, which is moisture vapor transmission rate or water vapor transmission rate, expressed in grams of water vapor allowed to pass through meter square of a fabric for 24 hours. That is one day. And let me tell you, in a tropical climate like ours, we perspire for 300 grams of sweat in 1 hour. And what at least we are being demanded for is to provide 500 grams of water vapor to be allowed in 1 meter square for 24 hours in our coveralls, which we have not been able to achieve. And international standards also say it's 1,000 for the MVTR, right? So we must pay attention, and you should not get misled by the value of air permeability, because air molecules are 100 times smaller than water vapor molecules. And of course, air, if you just relate this two together as the same, you will over predict your breathability. So next time when you are selecting a fabric, be sure that it's the breathability parameter which is mentioned, right? The third demystification, that is the microporous versus monolithic, which I have been talking all throughout my slides. No poll this time. I'll straight away move to the next slide to clarify this. So this is how a microporous membrane looks like schematically. And this is how the coating microporous looks like. So they consist of pores, of course, which has been engineered in a manner that it is larger than what is intended to be obstructed and smaller than what is intended to pass through. Comparison between microporous and monolithic, I mentioned the name suggests it has got micropores. So the manner in which this water vapor passes through this barrier is the capillary action through these micropores. You will just see the animation now that these water vapors would be passing through the micropores available here, whereas the virus and the droplets or any other fluid is obstructed at the entry point. So they have certain degree of barrier protection against the liquids. Now going ahead with the monolithic, or which is also known as hydrophilic barrier layer, they are non-porous in nature. They do not have pores at all. However, the water vapor passage is provided through molecular diffusion by the help of these hydrophilic groups of orange color, which you see within the barrier layer, which takes it through from the skin microclimate to the outside environment, also because of the temperature and the humidity gradient which we have across our body and the environment. So if you talk about these two, and if I have to compare, monolithic barrier gives you 100% complete barrier, whereas microporous doesn't give you complete barrier. However, if you talk about the breathability, as I told, they are contradicting. For the case of microporous, breathability is higher than that of the monolithic barrier. So I hope I could demystify these three concepts for you all. And I would just like to have an optimistic journey ahead. So having discussed a lot about coating versus lamination and talking all good about lamination, that it is breathable, it has good barrier properties, and it doesn't block the pores, then why is that we have been seeing the coated fabric mostly in the market? There is one very important factor which I haven't discussed yet, and that's the cost parameters. And it is quite a lot of difference. The lamination process with the laminates is 7 to 10 times costlier than that of coating process and the coats available. So that itself answers the question. And I do not know several reasons. You may say there are technology involved, but I also feel that since we do not have any domestic production, also maybe the intellectual property is being guarded. We have commercial membranes existing which are breathable internationally. If we are intent, we have to import them. That might be a reason for this costly affair. So I feel it's time for us to look forward to having these membranes produced here in India. First target the barrier properties, then go forward for the viral barrier, and then make it breathable viral barrier. I understand you may say this is not that easy, but I also know that we have several research institutes who have specially membrane technology research area. We have done a lot in India for water purification, for food processing, and several other separation and purification through these membrane technology. So the technology of making these are known to us. However, we haven't engineered it for the virus protection. So we can very well take it off. Next in line, in this crisis situation, we are going for disposables. When we talk about reusable coveralls, we need to think about it because, of course, we in long term, it has bad effects on the whole system environment for the disposable. So we should, it's time for us to start thinking for the reusable coveralls, which would have all these properties stated here. And before I end, a very futuristic thing which I would add here is, time is not far. We may be asked to handle with such viruses, which is of the range as big as water vapor molecule or smaller than that. That point of time, we would require something known as smart breathable barrier, viral barrier, using biomimetrics, phase change material, shape memory polymers. We may, so I hope there would be few people who would be into research, they can take up and start thinking of about it. That's all from my side. And I thank you, everybody. I hope I could enlighten a bit and add to whatever understanding you had. I hand over back to Professor Jana now.
Thank you, Rishmi. I think that was a very enlightening and very clearly saying that what are the situation in India and how exactly the, let's say, the what are the status of fabric manufacturing and the technology angle. And I think before I hand over to Anshuman, I think I would like to ask again the attendee through a poll that what do they think about one of the very, very crucial technology of the seam sealing. So I would just like to see that what is the opinion currently. Now, what is needed for making the coverall? What do you think? Hot air seam sealing technology is a must, or both hot and cold sealing technology can work? Please give your options within the next 10 seconds. Yeah, can I have the result, please? Oh, yes. So it says that 50% of the attendee feels that hot air sealing, seam sealing technology is a must. And whereas a sizable number, I would say, that means all, we can say it is 50-50 probably. 44% still feels that both hot and cold sealing technology can work. I think after the next presentation, probably some of them will get their answers or probably change their views. So I, on this note, I think I will hand over to Anshuman, who is going to take you through this making and hot air seam sealing. Over to Anshuman. Anshuman, tumhare unmute karo. Unmute karo.
Yeah, good evening to all. Namaste. Thanks for Apparel Resources to give me the opportunity to work on and give my presentation to you people. So I would like to share of giving about the seam sealing and the stitching technology, basically more about critical process and parameters we are going to discuss to make a coverall. Generally, we all know about that we have to use a four thread overlock because all of the seams, it can be stitched fast, where we can keep a number 9 needle or somewhere, if you really want, you can go for number 11. So make it more faster and more easy to margin, make the margin even, because some, the jacket manufacturer generally, they keep the edge cutters in hand, but mostly the industry is available with the overlock. So important part is to have a even seam margin. We recommend to use maximum joining has to be done by a 3-thread overlock or a 4-thread overlock. Then single needle is used for especially the applications like zipper attach, and few cross seam and all those kind of applications, we have to do that. The important part
is seam sealing, where after stitching all the seams where the needle hole has been because of the needles, it has to be sealed with the special tape, barrier tape, we can say, with the help of cold seaming or a hot seaming. That already we have explained. We are going to talk about here on the cold, on the hot seam air, because hot air basically, the when the glue melt, and then it is more easy to be attached to the fabric which is suitable to the tape. That is very important to make it more effective barrier seam. So the garment, all the needles has to be closed. Three parameters are really important here when we talk about speed, temperature, and pressure. These are combinations. So we need to see, keep testing the things on what speed each operation can be done. All those kind of things are very important. Number of bursts, when we talk about the stop and goes process by while seam sealing, it has to be reduced. So it increases the quality of the seam sealing. So when we talk about the parameters, so we talk about a SAM about 11.81 minutes. And the seaming time will be about 5.4 minutes. Total number of operations, we can say about 13. Total number of seam sealing operations, we have like 8. So we divide into parts and assembly, where hood, sleeve, front, center back, and then testing. Then we go for the next seam, inseam, bottom hem, or the spandex, then zipper, and the front placket area. So if we do the assembly versus the parts versus assembly, seam sealed, stitched, seam sealed, and garmenting, it is more easy to make a good garment. This is a detailed operation. If anybody wants to share, they can contact me on WhatsApp so I can give them the details later on. So we say about 500 pieces you can achieve in 9 hours with the help of 8 seam sealing machines. This is a average on the 70% efficiency we calculated. When we talk about the importance of the stop and start of the sealing, if you see the right side picture, the two rollers, which is important, between that the tape and the fabric is going. So nozzle is basically heating the area. And when we stop, you can see the red portion, especially this red portion, that basically doesn't get the hot air immediately when you start again. So which results on the second picture, you can see there is a light blue color, which cannot be seen by eyes very easily, but there will be a weak seam sealing portions. So we need to understand that why we have to, like generally when we talk about many stops when we take, we have to avoid those things to make it better. When the seam sealing machine we are talking, we talk about the nozzle point, we talk about the we depend on the duration of the burst. Basically, we will be less heated, so we need to try to avoid maximum that portion to have a good seam sealing. To improve the seam sealing quality, few key features are very important. One of those is called micro reverse. So if I play this video, you can see this. Here we are trying to increase the micro reverse position. So here, when it stops, you can see the roller is coming back. And when it comes back, your nozzle face to the heating tape area section is more easy. So where we avoid the problem, which I have shown in the previous slide. So this micro reverse, we can be checked with the operator's efficiency, how efficient the operator is, also the speed or all the fabric, everything is related. We need to do different tests to make it good for your conditions. Another important feature is nozzle retract. So many of we see that when the things are ending, we got the wrinkles on the tape end side. So when you trim it, the nozzle stays for small time, the tape is finished, then it is calm. But there is a possibility that you need a little bit more longer time, where the nozzle comes after some time to to its home position, which will again increase the seam sealing quality, especially on the end of the tapes. So here we can see on this video, the trimmer is active, and now you can see after this also it goes about 1 cm, 2 cm more longer, then it comes back. So this helps us. Then we have the tensioner, which is very important because all the rolls has to be unwinded, because the fabric what we are going to use is doesn't have any stretchability. So it is very important. The tape has to come on the relaxed way. So there are IR sensor which is trying to release the tape before it comes to the hot seal. So we can increase also, if you want that speed to be directly related to the upper motor, upper roller motor, it can be directly synchronized, or if you want to run through the sensor, it can be programmed like that also. This slide says the tape width is very important with the nozzle width, with the upper roller and with the lower roller. For an example, suppose we are using a 20 mm tape width, we recommend to use a 20 mm or a 22 mm nozzle with a 22 mm upper roller and 24 mm lower roller. Lower roller is subjected to, if you are getting the impression marks, then only you need to be have very specific. Otherwise, a wider lower roller can also work with you. When we talk about the direction, if you see the picture, the first picture, it shows when the nozzle is blowing, the air is going, the hot air is going towards up, towards down, both sides. So basically we are wasting some of the hot air, and also it is reheating the wrong position of your tape, where we have to adjust these nozzles towards the, before the tape goes inside the rollers, it has to be melt down. So this nozzle adjustment according to our fabric, according to the quality or the speed we want to achieve, it can be adjusted with the different type of fabrics. Some fabrics are very delicate. So what happens if the nozzle is towards more down, it will burn the membrane of the fabric. So nozzle positioning angle, nozzle angle positioning setting is really important for seam sealing. We divide the tapes quality into three different portions. One is called tape start, so where you can see the functions which can be programmed in good machines: motor delay, coil delay, then tape feed length you can fix, tape feed speed you can fix, tape feed delay also you can speed, tape start, there is a blowing of soft start, that is also you can program. This is of tape start. Then in the tape middle, you can program about motor delay, where you are stopping and then it, how much late it should start the motor, micro reverse speed. Also, of course, the soft start, how we do in the Bartek and other machines, the soft stitch, soft start, that is the how you can do on the seam sealing. In the tape end, after cut, what should be the sealing speed? Some people think after the cutting, trimming, it should be finished very fast. But when you finish very fast, the hot air is not blown very good to the end of the tape, and there it is weak. So where the roller should stop, front blowing delay, how much blowing time, and nozzle retract. So these all features combination, we can adjust and make your seam sealing much better quality. The precautionary measures we should take during the stitching before the seam sealing. This is important point. Because during the stitching, we have to ensure the seam should be very flat. There should not be any pleats. Generally in sewing, we think, okay, whatever you do, it has to cover the tape. It is a wrong procedure, or I will say it's a wrong follow. We should make a very clean garment. Then the taping makes it more clear. If you see the picture, you can see the crotch area, especially we do a very, I will say, lousy type of stitching or gathering, which affects a failure of seam sealing. Stitching pattern construction should be very straight, depend on your fabric rigidness or the quality of the fabric. Need to avoid sharp angles and curves, especially underarm, crotch area, so that seam sealing should be done correctly. If we are using single needle lock stitch construction, need to maintain the seam margin between 3 to 4 mm. Uneven seam margin will lead to an improper seam sealing. All stitch seams to be sealed and tape should be on the laminated surface. I remember there was a question from some of the attendees. So they asked, should it be on the laminated surface only. And for the PPE coverall, it is basically the lamination is kept outside. Yes, there we can feel that after 24 hours or 36 hours, the tape reaction to the fabric is a little different. So that is very important. There is a test, there is a long test has to be done in proper time. So we understand which tape can be suitable for which fabric. And we need to give this test, we need to give the time because everybody is running short of time. So they just want to attach this, they don't want to attach that, and they just come to the conclusion. The scientific method or the practically, it has to be tested, it has to be kept for a long time to understand it. And then you make a final decision, okay, this is what is happening. Then seam margin centering need to be maintained. Means the tape which we are putting, we should see the stitch has to be on the center of the tape. Very important point is the shop floor or the production floor air ventilation. We are using many seam sealing machines where it is generating a hot air. If it is a low roof or if there are ceiling fans, the hot air goes up and again we are pressing that hot air towards the machines, which again affects. So basically the ventilation system has to be maintained well in the shop floor so the hot air doesn't stay inside the shop floor. Wherever the seam is ending or merging, we need to have, suppose there are like we have discussed that if you make the parts and make the seam sealing, there we don't face these kind of problems. But wherever we are doing in a complete garment, wherever the crossing area we find, we should not stop immediately on the crossing. It should go about 1 inch or 2 inches, depend on your seam requirement, and then we should stop. So this is very important. And in the morning, every machine should be tested with a small mock. It has to be kept ready with that same day mock has to be checked and then approved. Okay, now the machine is well to run. Here we are going to talk another important point. All the seams should be sealed from out to in. Out to in means suppose we are seaming like sleeve or we are doing an inseam. So inseam means we have to start from the feet side and come towards the crotch. So this video will explain you how we should do it. We have inserted the complete and then we started seam sealing. Here, most important, the crotch when it comes, we have to cross the crotch and stop about 2 inches here. And then we take a turn. Again, we start from the... feet side and again we cross it. Now we know this is a critical joint, a critical portion. Generally on the outer wears or the jackets or the long pants, seam sealed garments, we use a cross seam press. But here, this fabric doesn't suit to your press machines, heat press machines. So what we do, we use the same hot roller because the roller is hot and then we take to the seams and we just press it again. Again, a question, which side of the fabric or which side of the stitched garment we should do the taping. Seam sealing basically is known because the margin has to be sealed with a tape. The margin where we are putting the tape, that side is only the lamination. So it is very important for us to use the tape on that side. But how it affects? When we pull the both fabric after the seam sealing on the seam side, if you try to pull it, the tape, because it is already holding the seam margin, you won't feel that it is weak. The seam is weak. But if you put on the face side, means the lamination side you do, but the margin is on the other side, If you try to do the seam sealing and try to pull, you will find the tape will get weaker because the stitch is allowing you, the both the fabric, it is allowing you to pull each other, and there will be a little bit gap which will affect directly to the tape. So we always suggest we should use the seam sealing tape to where it covers the margin to increase the strength. Generally, in practically, we have seen this time, there are many fabrics where the membrane is too weak. Membrane is too weak. Why we are saying? Because when it is touching to the feed dogs or the anti-static static problems of the fabric, that it doesn't move on the sewing machine bed or whatever it happens. So people try to stitch it on the other side. The margin is in towards the non-laminated side, and they try to put the tape onto the lamination side. But it really affects the strength of the seam. Hydrostatic tester. As we know that ASTM 1671 is the synthetic blood penetration test. We cannot achieve it in our individual workshops or the production floors. So we always suggest to have a hydrostatic pressure test by using to be used to your fabrics as well as to the seams. Each and every roll when we receive of the fabric, we do the testing. And also same time, once the stitch things are done, we have to test the seam also. Here we are going to talk about the tapes. There are many tapes available in the market, but the tapes has to be according to the, depend on the fabric compatibility. So the most five major fabric, what we are seeing, six about fabric, what we have seen till today. One is PP, which is we called one of the best fabric. It is polypropylene, then it is PE, polyethylene. There is a name fabric, very famous called Tyvek. Then it is non-woven with PE lamination. Then it is non-woven with PE U lamination, then it is woven fabric with TPU lamination, then it is woven, then is a knitted fabric also is available, another grade, which is again with the lamination of TPU. Then we have seen some woven fabric with PVC coating also, some people are trying using it. So tape that suits for polypropylene, PP or PE, will be having a PE layer, which is a base layer, and then it is a ethylene vinyl acetate glue. For the TPU fabric, which is laminated with the the woven or the knits or whatever, it is basically we should use a PU tapes. Very important to, we should take the precautions how we should store the tapes. The seam sealing tape should be stored between 16 to 20 degree temperature, room temperature. And we know India is a hot country. Like Tirupur, it is more hot. So whenever using rolls on the shop floor, the machines are also hot. So what happens after some time, we feel the tape is not moving. So we should take back again to the, we should change the roll, take the old one back to the air conditioning or the ice box. And after some time, we can use it. Meantime, we can use the another roll. This has to be maintained. The storage, as I said, so the storage area is very important. We should not keep it in open off floor where it is directly affecting through the dust or to the direct heat. And tapes should be kept in horizontal positions. It cannot be kept on the roll sides because it will give the pressure to the sides and it will be more difficult for getting it relaxed. Then each operator should issue only one roll at a time. Once it finished, like how we do in the needle breakage system, that is the same system we should follow. Sufficient air cross ventilation, as we have discussed earlier, that is also very important. So this is all about, my friends. I hope this has given you a little bit guidance, what we are doing, because everybody is now practiced or understood what exactly they are facing. Thank you very much. Thanks to all.
Yeah, thank you, Anshuman. I think now we can take up the questions one by one. Also, some of the questions actually is probably have been asked before the presentation, some of the presentation started. So probably you've got some of the answers. I will pick up only those important ones which has come through in terms of. Now, what one question came is, what is seam welding? And also another related question probably is whether ultrasonic welding, how it can work and some kind of directions. So we need to understand the seam welding means that where the two plies are being attached by melting the fiber itself. There is no third substance, basically. There is no glue, there is no tape, there is no sewing, there is no sewing thread. That's called simply welding. And ultrasonic welding is one of the welding methods. Now, if you need to understand, because I just during my presentation, I said that probably ultrasonic welding will be 60% faster. So the logic behind that is that if you see that average sewing speed, what a average operator can work is, although this is a quite straightforward garment, but if you take average of 3000 SPM, the machine runs at 12 SPI, we get a roughly around 20 feet per minute the speed. If you look at the seam sealing speed of the speed of the seam sealing machine, which are running at approximately 60 feet per minute. Ultrasonic welding can run from 10 feet per minute to 120 to 160 feet per minute. So there is no limitation. So if we see that in the sewing is only the limitation. So even if we work at 20 feet per minute in ultrasonic welding, say in one go, we can complete it. So technically we can actually do it at 60% of the time because we don't need to do the sealing of the tape. The issues regarding currently, which is not very popular, is probably availability of the ultrasonic welding machine for joining of fabrics is not very, very common. Only this disposable bags, which are being popular instead of the polythene bags. So that's basically are a lot of those bags are actually joined by ultrasonic welding machine. Now also ultrasonic welding can be done two ways. One is a continuous roller type, and there is also there is some stamping type, which is the batch process. Almost all the masks are done by ultrasonic welding. So in terms of compatibility with the fabric, it is definitely a solution, but only thing is the technology need to be probably re-looked at a little bit. And as I told you that already there is a company who is doing it, so it is doable. I think the next question is something what although Rashmi has answered, although we are not going to name probably any manufacturers per se, but I think the scenario in India, probably Rashmi can probably highlight, because the question is name some breathable fabric manufacturers in India. So I think Rashmi would like to.
As I already mentioned, so Access, please understand fabrics are breathable, but it's the barrier layer which we are putting in, which is making it non-breathable. Now that layer has to be breathable. For that, you should understand, I just covered that key. If you're going for the coating process, it blocks the pores. So it's the membrane which you have to take up. And in that membrane also, both microporous as well as monolithic, both are breathable membranes. Of course, monolithic has a lesser thing. So talking about in India, the option available is to import, because as such, we do not have in-house production here in India, anybody making membranes which are meant to barrier to these viruses and are breathable as well. So there are companies, I quoted few of them in the last few slides, if you know that they are the commercial ones, but not they don't have manufacturing in India and we have to import it. So if you are looking for a breathable thing, you have to import and go for lamination. For coating, if you compromise, try to make it breathable, then it should be very, very carefully done without going ahead of certain add-on percentage so that it doesn't block the pores unnecessarily. I hope I answered that question.
Okay, I think there's some question for... before I actually pass on the questions to the or share with three of us, I think there are some questions came regarding the sharing the presentation video. I think that will be addressed once I hand over to Ila, because you can contact Apparel Resources, they will be able to provide it. So you can definitely get in touch with this. So we are only answering the technical questions, what is coming through. Now, one question came probably how the speed of seam sealing can be increased, which is probably because of the scarcity of the machine, people are trying to make as many as possible. And linking that, can viscose fabric be seam sealed? I think Anshuman how we can increase the speed, if at all we can. And the next is that whether viscose fabric can be seam sealed.
Okay, thank you, sir. The machine capabilities to handle the speed is very high. The machines are capable to do that. But frankly speaking, here it is not like a needle time or a sealing speed. It is very important the fabric, the tape, the operator, and the garment all together. It is a combination. Garment means application. So it is all depend what exactly we are doing, and we have to make a mix and match. Example, a straight seam, you can achieve a little bit higher speed. When we talk about, but this, when you increase the speed of that, you need to increase the temperature, you need to increase the, you need to set the machine according to that application. So when you are doing for a neck joining, since it is a curve, you need to change the speed, you need to change the settings. So if you do parts and assembly, you can still achieve in a different, but the test has to be done inside the factory and there with their operators and with their facility, they should do, okay, this is cleared, this is, the test is passed, okay, we can keep this. But if you change again the operator and they come and again sit on this machine, then you again change everything. So basically, we waste time making different changes as per the operator's comfortability. We should follow a standard system where all the machines are set proper. So anybody stand or sit anywhere, we just need to teach them how to handle the fabric. That is all what we have adjust. Then only one variation we need to control. Otherwise, if we try to do everything all together, it is difficult to maintain a quality.
Okay, thank you, Anshuman. There is one more question came regarding, I think, although probably at the end, Rashmi has covered about how to make a reusable coverall. The question is actually that how can we make reusable coverall matching all criteria? I think before I hand over to Rashmi, I think, you know, she has indicated like one of the, because three of the suggestion probably, you know, use tri-laminate, use oven, and probably use hot air seam sealing. So that I will say that, you know, as a point wise, that is, but I'll hand over to Rashmi if any other suggestion you want to say in terms of fabric wise for reusable coverall.
So yeah, thank you, Professor. So already added to your points are things like if you are targeting reusable, of course he touched upon the materials. So you should also look into that the material itself is stable to the sterilization process. When I say stable, it is different to that from resistant. Being resistant is meaning that it will not degrade. But when I say stable means the pore size should not increase, should not be distorted, there should not be cracks, there should not be holes, whatever is there, the barrier layer should not be affected. So in the sterilization process, there are things like you undergo autoclave at temperature of 120 degrees centigrade around for 15 to 20 minutes time. Then you have ethylene oxide being exposed. So all those things should also, because reusable means, of course, after the usage, you will be taking it for sterilization and then again using it. So it should be stable to that. So added to whatever Professor Jana has spoken. There are few things, a few more questions which I just saw. Somebody,
I was about to say that question has gone in so many number. I think, you know, all three of us.
I may miss few, but whatever is there on the screen, yeah. There is a question asking that what is the possibility of using regenerated cellulosic fiber, that is viscose or lyocell, based on fabric in PP, and also the possibility of seam sealing. Seam sealing, however, Mr. Anshuman will answer. But the usage of cellulosic fiber, we should understand that it is something which is hydrophilic in nature. That is, they absorb water. And the situation which we are planning, these coveralls are for the COVID scenario. So if at all we plan, first of all, we'll need to give it a finish, which will make it hydrophobic. That is, it should not be loving water anymore. And then if you at all plan to make it reusable, you should consider that those finishes should be stable to those sterilization and other processes. So I'm not sure if you would like to add on that cost of finishing and making something which is hydrophilic to hydrophobic rather than using something which is already hydrophobic. So that's the answer to that question. If anything else related to...
I think Rashmi...
I'll come back. When we
talk
about the seams...
think
when we talk about the seam sealing, it is very important. There has to be a line, or there is has to be a property that where the tape can be attached. If it is just fabric, there is no point that we can attach the tape. So it's not that easy. So it's very important to attach the tape or to the do the hot air seam sealing. The fabric should have a layer where we can do the attaching of the tape.
So that is important, that, you know, so where
yeah, most important
attached, so that the sticky property has to be there, which has to be created, a kind of thermoplastics. I think there is also Anshuman, you can take that, whether in the same, I think there is a question that whether in the same PP and PE, the same tape can be used or not. I think he has already said that the compatibility of the tape has to be selected very carefully. I think you can just repeat a little bit.
PP and PE, they have almost similar properties. So the PE tape can work on the PP and PE both. But PU has a different compatibility. So people generally use PU, but there are some PU with the property where you can attach the PE also.
Okay, I think there is a question on cold seam sealing, and which I will take that, because so the viewers get or the little balanced input. Although we started with, you know, before I think we got into the technology, that hot air seam sealing and cold air seam sealing. And in the context of because if you look at the sheer number and that, you know, amount of PPEs are made in the country, like if we, there was an announcement by, I think, Prime Minister Modi that we are making 2 lakhs per day. Although in my figure, I've just taken from one Twitter post a few days back, which was 1,87,000. If we go by that 2 lakh, and if we imagine that all 2 lakhs are made using the hot air seam sealing, so which will give us a number that definitely we are not making all with the hot air seam sealing. Let's face the fact. Obviously, we don't have that much of machine, that we know. So definitely there are hot and cold is getting mixed. Now the question comes that, you know, whether it is mandatory or not. So we have told you that how exactly the hot air seam sealing works, that technically what makes it standard and how it sticks. So the issue is that in the cold seam sealing, generally there is no machine. There are machine, but I don't think anybody in India is using any machine to do that. So the moment when you do it manually, first of all, even if the quality of the tape and the chemical reaction to attach everything probably up to the mark, but even the process of attaching is very, very, you know, inconsistent. So because when you attach by hand, you don't know what pressure it is and at what speed you are doing. So because of that, there are also a lot of complaints we have received, or a lot of people have called and, you know, trying to ask that why sometimes it is getting passed and sometimes it is getting failed, although all the fabric is remain same and the tape remains same. The issue is that process control is very, very important. In a hot air cold sealing machine, because you are doing it by machine, so all the parameters are controlled. Probably in a cold seam sealing, if you can control it to a certain extent for this one use or this disposable, you can still manage it, because so in the, you know, criteria, nowhere it is written whether it has to be hot or it has to be cold. But our experience shows that the hot air, we are able to maintain the standard, because we are not saying that one cover will make and get it passed and that's all. You need to get those thousands and thousands of sink, you know, this coverall to be made in your factory. And if you're doing it manually, it is no way you can actually do it consistently. That's the reason. So there is a kind of concern. And I think you need to understand this. It is not only the quality of tape, it is how you attach it. I think, you know, that question you'll be able to, I think I'm able to answer that. There is also, I think, another question regarding, I think Anshuman has answered that even after 24 hours, some of the cases, the tape is peeling off. Although it did not say that whether it was a hot or cold. So, but in case, Anshuman, can you throw some light in case, any cases where the hot air seam sealing tape also will peel off, and what can actually gone wrong? So how they can address that, probably some setting? Is there any case you have faced?
Yes, sir. I will give a clear thing. See, these are all chemicals on the glues, what we are using as a glue on the hot air seam sealing tapes. The tapes which have been attached to the garment with a quite tension, where it is pulled or whatever. So after some time, the shrinkage will work. There will be a brittleness of glue that can be also happen there if the proper temperature is not achieved while attaching the seam sealing, that will also affect. So there are many reasons. To minimize these reasons, whenever we set up the machine on the bi-laminated fabric or a tri-laminated fabric, we attach the seam sealing, then we keep for a few minutes, and then we try to do a pull test. So when we do the pull test, the tape has to come with a layer. It should tear the layer from the fabric. That is how we test it. Very difficult for us because of the time constraint. So everybody is saying it is PE or it is PU or this one. We have to believe and we have to work on that. That is how we are working at this moment. But scientifically, it has to be tested. And for the testing, it has to be about minimum 3 to 4 days while doing all the kind of tests to have patients to get back that what is the result and how it's affecting. This is most important part. Then generally due to the supply chain of the fabrics on this, similarly fabric again, you want to go with the same, you won't get it. So you jump into the other where the lamination thickness is different also, or the base layer thickness is different, that also affects. So there are many variations which we need to work together to understand it. And then, but it is true that after 2 days or after 3 days, you must have seen there are a few jackets after a year or 6 months, you can see there is a white formation on the tapes. So it is basically that has its own life. So there are many things related with this.
Okay, I think Anshuman, you can continue with another question which came. Probably, I think this might be in a lot of people's mind, that what are the initial investment in setting up, let's say, coverall manufacturing unit? It says PPE manufacturing, but I assume that it is actually they're asking. But I think it will depend on obviously size and capacity, but I think you can just roughly indicate the cost of machines and...
See, it's about 16 to 18 machines maximum to do in a 500 garments 9 hours shift. But generally we prefer that seam sealing should run on two shifts so that they can achieve that, achieve the cost back of investment. So normally as 9 machines, 8 to 9 machines overlock, 2 about single needles and 6 to 8 machines on seam sealing side. So that is how the investment. So machine ranges, overlock and single needle, everybody knows. Seam sealing in this market available from lower side, if you can say 2,500 onwards to goes to 9,000, 10,000, $12,000 also depend on facility. But we will say a good machine can be achieved maximum between up to $5,600. You can get a very good for your coverall things.
And I think I just like to add that, you know, it is not only that we'll be able to make coveralls, because I think now everybody should know that if you are investing, that it is not only, don't think about you will be making only coveralls and coveralls. So don't look at that shorter view, because you need to think that, you know, how these machines can be used for other product. Because, you know, your market, you do not know how long you'll be able to only make coveralls. So you should not be left with that, you know, after probably the requirement goes away. So you'll think about what I'll do with these machines. So it's not like that, because this machine, as you know, in the beginning we said, that these machines actually are used for making outerwear. So you should, anybody is investing, should keep in mind that probably in some point of time, they will be diversifying into that kind of product. So keeping that in mind, they should select the machines. I think one question I would like to take, although because that's not the, let's say our scope. And I think we also had debated a lot in terms of how to sanitize. Because this is a very, very, I think, important question which is coming up, where they are discussed a lot. There are some technology exists today, and there are some, let's say, help can be available. You can get in touch with us. We'll put you in touch with, let's say, people there. there are ozone based sanitation, let's say sterilization going on. There are people who are, let's say, kind of giving this kind of facility. So that is there. Also, one question came from that the market size of material suppliers. Now, to be very frank, we don't want to be very critical about what is, because when I've said that this is 257 fabric suppliers, this was actually from the CIPTRA approved list. But, and they actually, I think, come out with the list every week once. So the latest on 7th May list actually is 257. Now we have tallied actually the earlier list with this list, then we realize that there are some common and there are some uncommon also. So our number goes up to be very frank, 303. Now the issue is now I think in our country, because a lot of these are actually one manufacturer and registered in three names or four names, those kind of things will be there. So in terms of actual, let's say, capability of supplier, because without going into the number, if we say that how many square meter of fabric can be made, those kind of, let's say, limit, I don't know whether we will be able to give you a figure or not, but we try to find out. I think Rashmi, if you can correct me, that in terms of laminated fabrics, we try to find out that India has only capacity of 10,000 meter per day, right? That is for the lamination, which is a rare kind of scenario today, at India at least. So in terms of coating, we don't know. That's the reason I'm saying that, you know, the number of manufacturers registered, if I go, then it is 300 plus. But total capacity of them, probably there will be a lot of commonness, which is similar for even PPE manufacturers we know. So going by that, I think it will be very difficult for us to give you an actual, you know, scenario of what is the capacity.
Can I take one or two questions?
Yes,
find important.
Because I have
asked regarding the bursting strength and the seam strength which is required. So as such, like for making this coveralls reusable, as well as like for disposables also, you should look into a seam strength of 20 newtons, it says, to be serviceable for the purpose, and bursting strength of 40 kilopascal is enough. So these two are the factors which judges the durability. So that's the figure which I can give you as per the experience. And then there is one thing more which I would like to address here, which was not there in my presentation, but someone has asked regarding the, again and again, there are two, three questions regarding GSM. And somebody has asked that three layer, what should be the ideal GSM and which is the correct one. So again, repeating, there is nothing as ideal. What one should target is that since GSM is directly affecting that, what is the weight which a healthcare worker has to carry when he's wearing that coverall. So just take that into account. And that is why we say that 60 GSM is something which is decent. Now talking about the three layer, so maybe you have asked this question thinking that making three layers would make it heavier further. So let me tell you, when we are dealing with two non-wovens, the barrier layer sandwiched between two non-wovens, in those cases, those non-wovens are spun bonded. And spun bonded non-wovens can go as low as a GSM of 10, 15, 20 GSM also, a single layer. So there doesn't lie any issue. Yes, when you are handling woven, you might face a challenge. For that purpose, when you make this three layers of reusable coveralls, so what you do is, normally what is done and practiced across this sector is that you have a base layer of woven fabric, then you have the barrier layer over which you have a specially designed film which safeguards these membranes, these barriers. They actually do not go for sandwiching these things between two wovens. That's the good practice, like international standard of practice, so that they don't compromise with the GSM, they do not go on the higher side. So that is how you do the trade-off between the GSM and the barrier. I think I answered these two. So if anything, it would come from
regarding one was actually, or there are many questions.
What ARP
is peeling off? I think you should contact, because already Anshuman has told in detail. Because it might be a compatibility issue, it might be a processing parameters issue, and which is very difficult to answer probably without getting into all. One of the questions was that whether these hot air CV-CD machines are imported or Indian. Now, till this crisis began, India did not have a single hot air CV-CD machine manufactured in India. And for the viewers, probably don't not only is hot air CV-CD machine, India does not make a industrial grade sewing machine also in India. So forget about hot air CV-CD. But I think within last, I think before 3 days, there was some announcement that in Rajkot, there is a company who has made in India hot air seam sealing machine who said that they are going to manufacture 200. So that's, you can log on and then probably in the net this news is there. So this but obviously it is going to take time to, you know, machine making is not that easy in terms of, because you need the service, you need to have the consistency. But yes, it is a good beginning in terms of that this crisis had made people to think in this line, so which is very, very appreciable. And I think I would like to share that in this crisis, there are two garment manufacturers who has also manufactured a homegrown hot air seam sealing machine. But obviously, we cannot, let's say, compare the kind of features what you get in a machines which are already established brand and compare to what you can make. So these are basically Jugaad. So which is now their performance of those are definitely depends on what all features those has. I think we can now we is there are questions regarding masks or whatever. I think Anshuman, you want to take last question? Yes.
Take the last question. It's very important. People are very much interested to know about the tape width. So frankly speaking, we need to take out from our mind that how more width of the tape it has, that will be more protection. Actually, it is not like that. If we need to control our seam margin, so if the seam margin is well controlled between 3.5 to 6 mm, so keeping both side and both the side 7 mm or 6 mm margins, 18 mm to 22 mm tape can be a very good tape for your seam sealing process. Important part is if you want to do a hot air machine, as I explained in my presentation also, the tape width has to be very much related with your nozzle width, which is the hot air is blowing, because if the width of the tape is less and the nozzle is blowing a little bit higher, then it will burn the edges of the fabric where the tape is getting attached. So we need to be selection of those all three things are very important. But a standard tape for hot air machines is basically used in market from 18 to 22 mm.
Okay, thank you, Anshuman. Thank you, Rashmi. And I will now hand over the baton back to Ila. And I would again thank Apple Resources from all three of us that for arranging this very, very, I think, you know, needed workshop. And I think we are able to answer some of the technical queries from the audience. And thank you very much. Back to Ila.
Thank you, Prabhuji. And that was indeed a very, very enriching webinar. And I can see the questions still coming in. Thank you, panelists, Dr. Jana, Professor Thakur, and Anshuman. And I'm sure there are a lot more questions people would be interested to know about in more detail. And for our attendees, you can see the email IDs below the slide on your screen. And you can contact them directly. And I'm sure they will be more than capable and interested to answer your questions. To know more about PPE, I would also suggest that you go to apparelresources.com. Wherein you will be able to know more about the developments in the PPE sector, the market, and many other things. And not only the PPE, but also a lot of other things which are related to the fashion business industry. And for our attendees here, we have a special offer. And we are giving you a surprise, 50% off on an AR digital subscription. And to avail it, all you have to do is use the promo code shown on your screen here, that is AR50, and you will be a part of the Apparel Resources family and be able to keep updated on all global apparel and fashion business news.